Hello, welcome back to the Business Excellence Summit. Today we have a really great topic that we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about the benefits of learning your customers' traits in order to increase your results. And my guest expert today is Alan Stevens. Alan is known as the celebrity profiler and also Australia's leading personality and business profiler. So let me introduce you to Alan Stevens. Hello, Alan. Thanks for being here.
Thank you very much for inviting me along. It's lovely to be here.
Oh, no, I mean, I really appreciate you, coming on and sharing a little bit about more about, why don't you just tell us a little bit about who you are, what you do? I mean, especially like about the whole profiler, just give us a little insight about who you are and how you got to where you are today.
Well, that's a fairly long story as far as how I got to be at this point at this time. But what profiling is about, first of all, is being able to read people. So being able to look at their facial features and being able to recognize their personalities in an instant. At the same time, being able to watch their body language, the expressions on their face that tell you their true emotions. And when you put all that together, you can pretty much work out in a very short period of time a person's character. So you know whether you want to do business with them, you want to be associated with them or whatever. How I got into that, I'd always been working with people, quite often thrown in at the deep end. I had, when I worked in what we call telecom over here, or now it's Telstra, our main communications company, I was put in charge of a group of people who were all older than me. In fact, one of the people in the team was my supervisor years before in Sydney. So when I moved to Newcastle, now I was in charge of him. And I found that I had to get to know people very quickly to be able to get them on side. Then I joined the surf club, where I joined in my later years as the club captain. And now I was telling people who had been with the club from the very early age what they had to do. So now I was the new boy on the block, but much older than everybody, whereas before I was in much younger. And so I was uncomfortable in all those positions. So I was always having opposition. So I had to find a way around it very quickly. And so I had to start looking at how to meet and connect with people very quickly, get them on site, understand them. And I've tried many things. I tried psychometric profiling for a while, where you look at somebody and you give them questions and they answer those questions. Now, with the problem with that, people tell stories. They lie. If you're applying for a job, for instance, you want the job, you'll always be asking, what are they actually asking you? How do I have to answer it? Then for a while, I was teaching currency trading. And with the currency trading, I was looking at trying to make sure that people stayed in the game long enough. So I needed to understand their personalities. And of course, they were doing exactly the same thing, answering those questionnaires in line with what they thought they had to be. But to stay in the trading game, you need to know your personality because you always revert back to type. And somebody just mentioned to me one day, you ever looked at reading faces? Now, you have a coach over there in America, John Wooden, who had stated that the most important thing you'll ever learn is the next thing you learn after you think you know everything. So that's been my philosophy for all my life. So I went and searched and found the experts in those areas, trained with the different modalities, micro expressions, then the facial features, and thought, why aren't these skills being used together? So I brought those together with reading body language and using NLP to be able to know how to actually talk to the person. So that's how it all came about.
Wow, that's very interesting. So now, I mean, why would it be so important for like entrepreneurs to learn, how to read their, potential customers or even their customers' traits in order to work with it better with them? Or how would it benefit them if they would learn it?
Well, let's look at anybody who buys from us. They don't buy unless they like us. They've got to be able to trust us. Same as you. Now, we look at anybody, we go out to buy any services, we're looking at the people who we're dealing with. If we don't like them, we'll go somewhere else. So building rapport is the most important thing. And you've only got about a tenth of a second, and people have already made a judgment. As soon as they see you, they've already decided whether they like you or not. They're thinking about people that they've dealt with in the past that you might look like, etc. So you need to be able to make that connection very quickly. So if you can read their traits, you know how to talk to them. So you can build instant rapport.
Okay. So can you like give some examples as far as like some basic things that someone can do to read someone better?
The first thing we always do is we look at the overall shape of the face, so the width of the face, the closeness of the eyes, the height of the eyebrows. When you come up to somebody and the eyebrows are fairly high up, there's a big gap between the eye and the eyebrow. This is somebody who requires a bit more space. Now, I'm more the other way. My eyebrows are close to my eyes. So I'm very comfortable standing close to people. Now, if I go up to somebody who is more discerning, who has a higher set of eyebrows, and I stand too close, they will step back. Now, if I'm not thinking and I then step in to close that gap so that I'm comfortable again, next thing you know, I'm chasing them around the room because they're moving away and all they're thinking about is I've invaded their space. So I want to make sure that doesn't happen. So if they've got high set eyebrows, I reach further out, I shake hands with them. I'm still friendly, but from my distance, I'll know that I've got rapport with them when they start coming closer. And while I'm talking to them, I can actually lower my voice. And as I lower my voice, if they then step in, I know they're interested in what I'm talking about and they've also gained a little bit more trust of me. So they're as friendly as anybody else, but they need to get to know you first.
Okay, so the eyebrows is one thing. Is there anything else about the facial expression or anything like that that we should look out for to, you know, better work with people?
Well, again, then when you actually start talking to the person, how much information do you give them? Now, there'll be a lot of your listeners who will be thinking, well, yes, when I've gone up to speak to somebody, I've been talking to them, there's been a great connection, and then all of a sudden they've lost interest. You know, the lights have gone out in their eyes. They look like they want to get out of there. That'll be because they've spoken too much. Now, I know that when I look at you, for instance, I know that you need a bit more, you just need the big picture. Don't overload you with a lot of details. If you're interested in what's being spoken, then you'll ask questions, but you'd like to control what questions you ask. Whereas I know if I just went rambling on, I'd lose you pretty quickly. So we're looking at the exposure of the eyelids. Now, there's a fold above the eyes. In a lot of people, the eyebrow comes right underneath it. The eyelid, I should say, comes up underneath it. Where you have a gap between the two and there's skin between the eyelash and the fold underneath the eyebrow, somewhere in here, they're the people who want the big picture. Where the eyelash is underneath, they're the people who need to analyze everything, which is a little bit like mine.
That's interesting. I mean, yeah, it's true though. I mean, I do like more like facts and just give me the spill real quick and then I ask questions and stuff. I don't really like anyone that rambles on for hours and I'm just sitting on like, okay, are you done yet? So yeah, it makes sense. It makes sense. Anything
else?
So
I'll have to remember that while I'm answering your questions as well.
Say what?
So I'll have to remember that while I'm answering your questions as well.
Well, I mean, now it's not so much about me, you know, I mean, it's about the audience, you know, not everyone is like me. So, I mean, you can feel free to elaborate because, I mean, I really want the audience to really get a big picture or a better picture of, you know, how important it is to really read the people, like build a rapport, figure out how can you really work with them, especially because, I mean, I've heard about like reading body language and facial expression stuff. And I mean, you and me, we had talked before and you have given me some really great insights about, you know, about the whole reading faces and stuff. And I think it is very helpful for entrepreneurs, especially when they're working with someone, like you said. I mean, people need to know, like, and trust you. And I mean, if you, like you said, you know, if you talk to a person with the eyebrows, like, too high and stuff and they need the space and you get too close, if you don't know those things, you might, you know, scare them away or, you know, push them away in a way, and then they don't want to do business with you. So I think it's very important that we know what should we look out for as entrepreneurs when we do talk to people. So feel free to elaborate and share some more.
Will do. See, with the I know that with our, do you mind if I talk about you, talk about,
sure,
some of your traits?
Yeah, let me be the guinea pig.
Excellent. So it's always best when people can actually see what's being spoken about. Now, when I look at your face as well, I know that you like the big picture, but I know once you've got the information that you need, you make your decisions very quickly. You don't want to sit around. You just want, okay, give me the best way to do it. That fits. Let me get on with it. So
yep.
I know that when I'm actually presenting to you, not to keep talking at the same time, not to try and give you multiple options on how to do things. Give you the best one. And you'll go, yes, let's move on that and get moving with it straight away. Some people which have a what I call a mental motive, which is more like me, and this is in the area of the face between the section down here underneath the nose to the chin and compared to the overall height of the face, where there's a natural turn of the forehead here and the chin. Where this area is much larger in the proportion to this area, then you have somebody who is very physical, who wants to move quickly on things. In my particular case, it's a little bit smaller. And with that, I like to be able to think of the different opportunities and possibilities. And then I want to make my decision out of those. So I will take longer to make a decision. whereas other people will make their decisions much faster. I also know that you're extremely laid back as well. You're highly tolerant. You're happy to do tasks if you're something that's, what would you call it, a bit stressful. You'd be happy to move away from that, come back to it later on, whereas some people just cannot leave it alone. And with somebody who has closed-set eyes, if they're working on a project that is keeping them very busy and they're focused on it, you don't go over and tap them on the shoulders and say, come over here and give me a hand. Because if you do, they're going to actually feel like you've disrespected them, that you've told them that what they're doing is not important. And if they come over to help you, they'll be there physically, but their mind will still be with the problem that they were working on themselves. But if you said to them, if I gave you 5 or 10 minutes, and that would that be enough time to get your what you're doing to that level, because I know it's important to you, then come over and give me a hand. You negotiate it with it, and then they will come over at that point. And when they come over, they're more likely to come over and bring their thoughts with them, so they're able to help you on the project. So it's all about building cooperation with people as well. The more you can talk to their traits, the more they feel respected, the more they feel that they're recognised, and the more they'll cooperate as well. So the traits cover a lot of things, not just talking to somebody, but how to actually work with them as well. But I also look at whether a person is their level of confidence as well. Now, you're what I would put into the middle category. It's more about somebody who is, as a mediator, who would work well with those that are overconfident or those with a very highly confident, naturally who'd hear something for the first time and then automatically think they've got it and they're ready to run with it. Then at the other extreme, you have the people who build their confidence. They're the people that learn something and then have to go away and practice it and practice it. And they take longer to get there. But when they get there and they've got that showing confidence, then you know they know what they're doing very well. And the difference in those two faces is a wide and narrow face. When you see somebody who's got a whitish face, they are people who have a high level of self-confidence. They will hear it once and think they've got it, and away they go. So they'll appear to everybody else to be very confident. The downside of the trait is that you don't know whether they know it yet until they're put to the test. Whereas the narrow-faced person will take longer, but what they will do is once they get there, they really know their stuff very well. And so you don't have to worry about them. Trying to catch them out is very difficult by asking them questions. So you're looking at those things as well.
That's interesting. So you said I'm more like in the middle of those two, or I'm like more the wider face? I know I have a pretty round face.
I would put you in the middle, but towards the higher end, but not in the right in the very high end. The good point about being in the middle of any trait is that you're a mediator between the other two. So you can work very well with those that are very highly confident. You can see them, yes, you can see their confidence, but it's not a struggle to you. Whereas somebody who has got a narrow face would look at those with the wider face and go, well, they're a bit cocky. They think they know it, but do they know it? And while the wide face will look at the narrow face and go, come on, get a move on. You should have it ready by now. So being able to be in the middle, you can look at the other person at the far end and the narrow face and know straight away that they need a little bit more time and they may need to be able to come back and check with you. Now, I also know that you're a team player, so you're going to work within the team as well. So those people are very comfortable coming and talking to you.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, that makes sense. And also what you said earlier about, you know, like me with, you know, when I get stressed about something, I'm really the person that I have to step away from what I was doing and then go back later. I can't just sit there and, you know, try to get it done like right now. I actually like really have to step away and then maybe come back tomorrow with a fresh head and everything, calm down or whatever. And then I usually can get the stuff done. But yeah, so I think that's pretty interesting that you were able to figure that one out just by looking at my face.
Yeah, the good thing about it is by being able to see that, I would know that if you were doing something, I could see you were getting a bit of stress with it. If I was smart and working with you, I'd just get you to come give me a hand with something else. That would give you an excuse to get away from what you were doing.
Huh.
So it's all about building rapport with people. So it's all about the teamwork that we built. The beautiful part is everybody has traits. Everyone's traits are perfect for them because they're the ones that they have. Some were passed down in their genes, others that they've taken on due to their response to their environment. And at the end of the day, every trade has an upside and every trade has a downside. Now, those that have dramatic appreciation, who put a lot of flair into what they're doing, they're very good at presenting their naturals when it comes to being on stage. But they do stress the same way. They're very expressive with that as well. And for somebody who is ascetic, which is like me and like yourself, we're more level, more flatline. And we're, you know, under the surface, there might be stuff going on, but on the outside, people are seeing us very relaxed. Now, the person with dramatic appreciation is going along, up, little spit. They've got a pressure valve that lets off all the time. And so let off a little bit, let off a little bit, let off a little bit. And for us with aesthetic appreciation, my God, it's exhausting watching them. They seem like drama queens. The downside to our trait is that we don't have a valve. We have a lid that's tightly turned on, and it doesn't come off until the pressure's really built up. So we let it build up and build up and build up. Then there's a big spit. Then it goes back, the lid goes back on again, and we're flatlined again. So we seem to be very laid back. When we have that spit, everybody goes, oh, they must have been upset. But they don't know until we've had that one big spit, then we're back to flatlined again.
Oh, wow. Well, see, I usually just call it, you know, I went German on someone. When I blow up, I just like, I just went German on that person. See, I use it as an excuse for everything, and sometimes it works.
So the good thing is, once you understand the traits, you know why you do the things you do. So that's the first place you start. You learn to read them for yourself. When you know why you do the things you do and you know what brings it on, you can take control over that. So you can manage your the downside of your trait and fully express the upside, you know, where you have your gifts. At the same time, by reading somebody else, you know what to expect. So I know that if... I can see by your expressions, this is why I put the expressions with the facial features, that and your body language, that while I'm watching that, if I can see that there's some change, I know that the stress is starting to build up. So I can then come and have a chat with you, or, you know, get you to help me with something else that allows you to let that stress dissipate a bit, so you don't have that explosion. So I can make anybody I'm working with, the environment around them, much more conducive to their personalities as well. And if that's the case, then I have people who are more loyal. Mm. If I'm running an organisation, by being able to read your staff, it's not a matter of wrapping them in cotton wool and everything else. You treat them with respect. You treat them with authority. You give them authority. You give them responsibility. And if you talk to their traits, you'll find that they will acknowledge it and they become very loyal to you. And, of course, your business is going to make a lot more money and you'll have less staff turnovers.
Now, let me ask you something, though. I mean, because I think a lot of the listeners, they're also like solo entrepreneurs. So they work from home like me. I mean, most of my clients there, I talk to them over the phone, sometimes Skype. So how can we, is there any way that we can benefit from it if we're just talking to them over the phone? Can we still benefit from, you know, learning their traits, or how can we do that?
Yeah, well, I tell everybody that I'm a social media stalker. The first thing I do when I'm going to call somebody is, or talk to somebody, I'll go and look at their LinkedIn page, their websites, Facebook, etc. If I can see their face, I can profile them. I don't need to see them in life. I don't need to see a video. The facial features don't change overnight. Their emotions might, but their facial features won't. So their personality remains fairly constant over a period of time. So by being able to see their image, I can then immediately profile them, have an understanding of their personality, because I look at each of the traits and build an understanding. One trait is very dominant, another trait will either enhance it or moderate it, and I build an overall view. Now I know how to talk to that person. Then I'll get on the phone and ring them up and have a chat with them. So having the right photographs on your LinkedIn profiles, your websites, etc., they are paramount, because people look at it, and they've judged you within a few seconds, and they've decided whether they want to do business with you or not.
Yeah, makes sense. I've seen some pictures before. I'm like, yeah, I don't think I want to work with that person. I don't think I even want to talk to that person, especially if maybe the picture's even a little inappropriate. I wouldn't even want to talk to them. So I think we all do that. We all judge just by a picture. So it does make sense. But what I was going to ask you, and now I actually lost my train of thought. See, you blew my mind already. I mean, you said, you know, we can still, you know, how can we actually learn? Let's say so one of the listeners would like to find out more about how do you learn how to read faces. Where can they go? Is there like a book or anything like that? Or how can they really learn more about how to read faces?
Well, to allow people to get a bit of an interest in it and get a bit of a taste for it, I wrote an ebook, first of all, which is called The Face. How to get your perfect career to match your personality. That's up on Google and Google Play and Amazon. But it looks at about 20 traits. So when I look at somebody from the age of, or a newborn, for instance, I can see up to about 10 different traits in the newborn. By the time they're 5 years old, there's about 24 traits. By the time there's 10, there's about 60. By the time they're ready to leave school, there's about 60 traits I can see in total. So in the book, I took a third of each of those age ranges and put them in so that people get an understanding of how to read some of the traits, but also what some of the careers that may suit the people. So if you've got a student, for instance, and they're trying to figure out what subjects do I do in my final years because of what career am I going to take on, this should give them a little bit of a prompt and a bit of an understanding. I also built two mobile apps, which look at about 7 traits, and they're the ones that we might see in someone's face or judge when we first meet them. And the first app is called Profile Me, and it was designed so that you could profile yourself or somebody else, and Profile Me is just one word. And in that, if you profile yourself or you profile somebody else, it tells you about that person. Now, the app doesn't do the job for you. It's got a camera in it, but the only reason it's got a camera is if you're going to profile yourself, are my eyelids exposed or concealed? Have I got closed eyes or narrow, wide set eyes? You've got to go looking for a reflection somewhere. So the camera is there just so you can do that to get your own image. It tells you how to do it. You then go and do it, and it gives you a report at the end. And then the second one, Profile Match, it does the same 7 traits, but you profile yourself and you profile the other person, and it says, rightio, on this trait, you might be a level A, an A, B, or a C. So you're an A on this one. The other person you're going to talk to is a C. So how do I actually, this is the way I like to talk, but I need to change the way I speak to meet them. This is what I need to do. So it gives you instructions on that. So that one, if you're going to go and talk to somebody, go and find their photograph, profile yourself, profile them. Then you know how to talk to them as well when you get on the phone or actually go into their office, for instance, or go into a meeting with them. So I put those together. But outside of that, then I run courses, some public ones. I'm training via Skype pretty much around the world. I think the only two continents I haven't trained on so far is the North and South Pole. I'm sure I'll find somebody there I can train at some point.
Wow, that's interesting. Well, I mean, I definitely want to check out those apps too. But now, as far as, I mean, earlier you mentioned also like body language. So what exactly is how can you read the body language? You know, if you, let's say, is it easier to read the body language than the facial traits, or what do you think?
Well, when you're looking at body language, you're comparing, looking at with the facial expressions in this case, because both of those tell you the emotions, what the person's really feeling. Now, the face has 43 muscles. It can pull over 3,000 expressions, they tell us, but there are 7 which are universal. That's anger, contempt and disgust, happiness and sadness, fear and surprise. Now, if you feel any one of those emotions, the equivalent expression will be on your face, and it doesn't matter whether you're being born in a tribal village, a capital city, or even being blind from birth, you will still pull that expression on your face when you feel that particular emotion. There is really fast, there are 50 of a second down to a 25th. So your unconscious mind, when you hear something, you respond emotionally. Your conscious mind steps in and shuts it off. So in that duration, everything can be read. Now, if you can control your face, your body will give it away. If you control your body, your face will give it away because there's too much going on for you to control everything. So if you can observe and watch somebody with both of those areas, you will pick up what's going on. So you might be talking to somebody about a dear friend of theirs, and you just found out that their dear friend has just broken up with their partner, and you see a sudden little twitch of a smile. You know that they're happy about it, but you don't know why. It could be that I'm glad they got away from them because they were nasty. Or my friend really deserves a bit of a kick in the bum. It's been a bit cocky lately, so that's good. Or their partner's free. It could be a whole range of reasons. Now it's my shot at them. So you've got to be able to test it. So like body language, you don't just take it on one indicator. You're looking at the whole picture. You're looking at it in context, in if the other are congruent with what else is going on. So if you get one body language saying one thing, another body language saying something else, like a folded arms means I'm supposed to be shut off, but it could be because I'm cold. It could be because this is why I am comfortable. This is why I think. But what's the rest of my body language telling you? Am I leaning in? Am I asking you questions? That would then contradict this as being a barrier. So what is my face telling you at the same time? So you look for all those and you're building a picture. Then you ask questions. That's why the NLP was brought into the process as well. Neurolinguistic programming. How do I ask questions to elicit particular answers or responses from the person that told me what's really going on?
That's interesting. I actually looked into NLP before, but it was a little confusing to me and I kind of lost interest. But I think it does. I think it is very important that you really, you know, listen, not just listen to your clients or potential clients, but also look at how are they acting? How are they behaving? How is their facial impression? Like you said, also their body impression. And I think once you kind of have an eye for that, I think you're going to be able to close a lot more sales, make the clients a lot more happier because you're actually going down to their level in a way, or like, you know, meeting halfway and providing better service. Or did I kind of get that right?
That's exactly right. The more you can understand somebody, the more rapport you're going to have, and the more understanding of whether they're actually listening to you, whether they're connected to you or not. And from there, you know what, you know, you've got your conversation going right. You know when to ask for the closure of the deal. You know if you need to give them more information. If you've got somebody who is nodding and going yes, 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 and all their traits tell you that they make their decisions very quickly, but tomorrow, especially if there's a cooling off period, they may change their mind. Well, you know then to go, okay, well, I know you've got all that, but let's cover a couple of other points. I need to cover this first. So you make sure that they understand fully. Don't just think they've got it. And so the more you can read them, the more you're able to close those deals faster and stronger as well. So they last.
Yeah, I actually had that before when actually with my son, where he was one of them. Like when I said something, he just like nodded his head. Mm-hmm, yeah, I got it. And I just could see in his face and his eyes, he had no clue what I was talking about. Like, and I asked him, did you even understand what I was saying? No. So, I mean, it does make sense, you know, if you really read them like that and you can really pay attention. And it happened to me before with other people where they really said, yes, they understand, but then they really, it totally went over their head what I was saying. So I think it's really important that you really watch out for that, because you can lose people, especially like for me. I know my problem is like when I talk tech and when I talk, really use those technical lingos about like landing pages, sales funnels, all these things. Some people just really don't know. And if you don't really pay attention to their facial expression, you might think they get it, but it totally went over their head and they have no idea of what you were talking about.
That's it. And a lot of people miss that completely when they're talking to people. They're just getting the verbal response and they think that they've got it at that point. But we know in communications, the words are only worth about 7% of everything else. And non-verbals, the body language, the tone of voice, all of that makes up the other 93%. And so if you just concentrate on the words, you're not going to be as successful. So as I keep saying to people, I can't hear a word you're saying because your actions are deafening. So it's always a case of are the non-verbals and the words matching up. So if you concentrate on the non-verbals, you'll have a much better understanding of the person, and you'll be more credible with them because they're able to connect with them more effectively.
Yeah. And now, as far as the DISC assessment, how do you feel about that? I mean, let's say if any of the listeners don't want to learn how to do read the facial expression or body language, can the DISC assessment help with that as well, to learn the traits of a person?
See, DISC, like Myers-Briggs and all those other psychometric profiles, they have a place. You know, they're designed mainly. I put a video out recently to sort of explain it. I used to use those systems. When I was doing the currency trading and teaching currency trading, I had my students do a profile first. And always when I started teaching them, in most cases, I'd go, that's not their personality. There's something going on here. And when I asked them about it, they said, well, look, we just tried to figure out what personality we had to have. And as I think I said before, that you'll always revert back to your own personality. So I needed to know that. So that's why I started looking for other methods. And that's when I found reading their faces. But this, what actually happens is the person will try and second guess it. I know that businesses use it a lot for employment, but across the general public, we've got about 1% of the population fit within the psychopathic profile. In management positions, though, it's 4%. So obviously they get through those psychometric profiles and interview techniques extremely easily. So, and I always see those psychometric profiles, the real role of those is for the person who's doing the interviewing or is sending the test out, because they need to understand that other person. If everyone just came through the door and we didn't understand them, we wouldn't be able to look at them and go, well, who fits? So the assessor needs to be able to sort of put them in a box. Then I come along and go, okay, now we'll take the person out of the box, and I'd say to the person, now we'll look at you as an individual on your own, in your own merits. Would you like that? So that's where the difference comes in. So I know that some assessors will say, well, I don't need to ask the questions. But if they're having a good day or a bad day, they're going to view the other person because differently, because they don't have a something tangible to measure it against. Whereas when I look at the face, I'm looking at dimensions. I'm looking at the width to the height, which is a mathematical thing. It's the width divided by the length of the face. So I'm going to get a fraction or a percentage. And it doesn't matter if I'm happy or sad, I'm still going to get the same reading. So with my reading, there is no emotional connection by either the person being tested or the person who's running the test. But if you're applying for a job and the organisation has to cull numbers, psychometric profiles are perfect for that. So I don't tell organisations to get rid of those programs. I go, keep those. That gives you a basis on where to start. Now put my stuff on top, and that can also help to support, yes, you got the right results, or no, the person tried to fudge the figures. Then when you get them in the interview, now you use the body language, the micro expressions, and the NLP, how you actually ask the questions, to then confirm, are they who they say they are? You've got that final confirmation. So I look at someone's photograph and I get a great deal of information about their personality. I then get them to say, watch a video, and I can get a lot more about their body language and their expressions depending on what's going on there. Then if I get them in an interview where they're live and now I can interact with them, now I've got so much more information again. So this is why I've used the four skills together.
That's interesting. But I mean, I'm pretty sure like not all of the listeners, they actually want to go out and learn everything. But so that DISC would be a good way to get started to help them. Because I know a lot of coaches actually use the DISC assessment just to kind of get a better understanding of, you know, like their potential clients or their clients, to get a better understanding how they should work with them. So, I mean, do you think that would be enough, or should they still learn more to provide better services?
Well, the more you know, the better you're going to be. The worst thing is to only have a little bit of knowledge. The DISC programs are good. What I still believe that I want to be able to assess the person and know that my emotions are out of the role as well. So my advice to anybody who's using DISC is to make sure that you're in a great, you know, a comfortable state and everything else. You know where your head's at if you're going to assess somebody. Usually if you're going to do it by asking questions, you've got to get their involvement in asking the questions. Now, you can't do that with young children. You can't do that with people who are of different cultural backgrounds. And you certainly can't do it to somebody who's coming to buy something from you. Let me profile you first by answering these questions.
So it might be a little weird.
It's got its limitations. Yeah. But it does help you categorize somebody into boxes. You've got about 16 different boxes with the DISC programs. When you look at mine, there are 7 billion people on the planet, and everybody is looked at as an individual. So we've got 7 billion possibilities as opposed to 16 different boxes. So the more defined you are, the more accurate you're going to be in understanding that person. So it's stages. You just got to look at, well, where am I and what am I doing? So to what level do I really need to know that person? And the more that you feel that you need to really understand them, then the more that you need to learn.
But I think it's also helpful to learn more about yourself. I mean, I've taken the DISC assessment for myself, and when I was reading through it, I'm like, wow, I mean, that's just amazing. And it really helped me shift some stuff around, because there are certain things that I didn't know about myself. And then when I took the DISC test and I really learned that stuff about me, then I'm like, huh, That's why I was doing the things the way I did them. And it made a lot more sense. And I think there's even a section in there that can help you when you're high in one area, how you can kind of match it in another area to more even out, I believe, right? I mean, when I took my test, it was like a long time ago or a little while ago.
Yeah, well, what I also do is I profile people from their photographs. So people can go to my website and actually put an order in and request me to do a profile. Now, that can be done from a point of view of, I just want to know how people see me. How do I come across? What do I need to do to present in a different way? So I can do a profile at that level. I can go down further into it to look at, well, what career, sports and hobbies may suit them as well. But I quite often profile couples. And what the couples will do, they will go through their profiles and understand themselves better. They will swap their profiles with each other. And they can then sit down and go, okay, this is where similarities are. And this is where our differences are. So where we have similarities in our personalities, this is where we have that soulmate connection, because it's very much like ourselves. If, you know, one person may like to sit down, watch movies, things like that, the other person does, it's a nice, easy relationship. But where there's differences, and this is where usually there's the spice in the relationship, that's because of the different personalities. But over time, what we can actually find is that the spice starts to disappear a little bit, and now it becomes a maintenance issue. But if you're able to understand the other one's personality, you talk to their traits and you get around that. It's like the five love languages, whether the person wants acts of service, physical touch, words of affirmation. Well, with my stuff, well, how do you speak those words of affirmation? What sort of physical touch? All of that you can pick up in the facial features as well. So couples now can use those profiles to understand each other better. Parent and children, how do I actually understand my child? I had one of the courses I was running, one of the girls there asked me to profile a friend of hers who'd given me her photographs of all of the daughters, the 14-year-old daughter. We profiled the daughter because mum wasn't getting on with the daughter. They were clashing a lot. And the girl had just changed from one school, co-ed school, to a private girls' school, and there were a lot of issues. So we then profiled mum, and I said, well, this is the difference in their personalities. Neither is wrong, but their personalities are so different. That's why they're not communicating. The advice went back to mum on how she needed to change the way she spoke to her daughter. Problem was pretty well solved.
Wow.
So when you understand the other one's personality, on my website, on the testimonial page, there's over 75 testimonials in it. 22 of them are video, and more than 11 of them now are testimonials that weren't straight after the fact. They were 9 months, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, and 4 years after I'd done the work with the people, and they're still getting results. Wow. A mother with a boy with Asperger's, who the boy had Asperger's at school, wanted to kick him out when he was 6 years old. When he was 10, his mother did a testimonial for me, so 4 years after when I profiled her for him. He's no longer seeing a psychologist. He's doing presentations in front of the class. He's back into the mainstream, all because the teachers took on board up to the mother when he was 6 years old.
Wow. So that's interesting. This is
used in mental health, though I use it in couples' relationships, people understanding themselves better, their partners, their children. Wherever two people interact, these skills can be used. They're unlimited, and wow, they fit under everything else. You'll put it on top of your disc programming, etc. It takes it to another level again.
Yeah, it sounds that way. I mean, it really makes sense if you do read, you know, someone to that level, and you know, you can change the way you talk to them, the way you handle certain situations and stuff. I really think it can make a big difference, not just in business but also in life itself, right?
That's it, because it's not just people who come to me and say, right, I want to learn this for my business. When we're going through it, they're learning about themselves as well. But then they go, part of the program when I'm teaching them, I go, well, let's get some faces that you really know. You know their behaviours. Bring those photographs along, and then we go from their behaviours and understand, well, this is a connection to their facial features. This is why they do what they do. And some of the salesmen and women that I've trained have come back to me later on and gone, well, it was great. I'm using this in my business, but I finally worked out the wife or the husband. I finally understand the kids. We've got better relationships. And I go, well, once you start learning it for one purpose, you'll use it everywhere. It's something that once you're using, you just love using it, making better connections with people. It's about building stronger rapport and better relationships.
Yeah, no, most definitely. I mean, you have to build relationships. I mean, no matter what, and especially, I think if you're an entrepreneur, and especially if you're working by yourself, you have to build those relationships. So otherwise, I mean, you're not going to have no clients. You're not going to have no customers if you can't connect with them. I had learned before, like even when I was going through coaching school, that like rapport, building rapport is like the very first thing that you have to do with clients. You have to build that rapport. You have to basically connect with them for them to actually let you in a way. So you can actually work with them or actually present to them, and so they can consider working with you. Because like you said, people need to know, like, and trust you. And if they don't know you, if they don't like you, they're definitely not gonna trust you. They're definitely not gonna work with you. So I mean, I know there are different strategies that you can use to build that rapport, to build the trust, to get people to know you. And like you said earlier, just the one thing about like not get going too close to a person if they are not that kind of personality that likes being close to someone like that. I think that is very valuable if you know something like that. So is there anything else that we really should watch out for that can really help us, something simple that we can do? And also how can we remember doing those things when we are in front of someone?
Well, one of the things that when it comes to micro expressions, for instance, people go, "Well, how do I learn them?" And I go, "Well, one of the best things you've got, YouTube is full of so many videos of people being questioned or interviewed, etc. If you watch an interview, say it was a criminal investigation or a political debate or whatever, and we listen to it, we get caught up in the words. Well, get those videos, turn the volume off. And watch the people's faces and look for changes in expressions. Then, when you'll see a change in someone's expression, play it back later on with the sound up, and you'll recognize when that expression comes up, you'll remember it again, consciously being wired to see it, and you'll hear what's going on. You go, hang on, that expression doesn't correlate with what was said here. So, you can start to pick up whether the people are being telling the truth or not, and you can play around with that and get a bit of an understanding of it. Then, as I said, you look for the basic traits. Pick a few that are very easy to see, like the ones I've got in the book or in the app. And you start practicing those and just looking at people, watching them, observing. It's via repetition, because that's how we learn anyway. We're rote learners. We learn things by doing it over and over again. So all of this stuff is easily learned. But watching the person's body language, whether they're closed off, whether they're moving away from you, etc. It's focusing on the other person, not focusing so much on what you're saying. Because while the focus is on you're missing everything else outside. So slow down, listen, ask the questions, then respond to the person's questions. So the best thing I've got, the advice I've got for anybody is be an active listener. Ask a question, listen to the response, then ask questions related to that. That will show the other person you're interested, and you'll build stronger rapport. You'll notice the expressions on their face, a lot more smiling, a lot more nodding, people coming closer to you as well. And it's in those that you'll know whether you're on track or not.
And I think that's really one problem is like a lot of people, they don't really listen. I mean, I've had that happening to me before when I was talking. I could tell the people weren't really listening. And I mean, I know for me as a coach, when I work with someone, I have to listen, like even listen in between the lines, like listen to the things that are not saying. And I mean, just from what you explained, it's kind of like the same with reading someone's facial expression or reading someone's body language, is you really have to actively listen and pay attention to the other person in order to pick up on those things. Because if you're just listening or watching with one eye and one ear, you're not going to pick up on those things. So you really have to actively pay attention to the person, put your inner chatter away, I guess, and then really just pay attention to the people. And then I guess you would pick up on those things, right?
That's exactly right. You'll do that. Focus on the other person takes the emphasis off you. The worst thing you can do is have a long script of questions that you want to ask. You should really, in the NLP, I keep it very simple. And I had the highest compliment paid to me from one of your teachers in one of the schools over there when she was looking at how to use my skills in the school. And she said, "Well, I've searched around," because she had to teach kids who were year 12 who were reading at elementary school level. And she had to teach them English. So everything she put in front of them, nothing worked. So she found an article by Paul Ekman. Now, Paul Ekman was the guy who did all the micro expression research. He's the authority in that field. But because he's a professor, it was very difficult for them to read. So she searched the web and she found me. And she paid me the highest compliment that she could have. She said, "Alan, please don't be offended, but I've looked at your website and everything's so simple. And I went, great, that's the way it was designed, so that everyone could understand it. And she said, well, what can you do? And I said, well, just keep things very simple, and that's the best one. Now, you mentioned you lost train of thought before. I've just lost my train of thought. Where was I going with that? Yeah, but the thing is to make sure that you just have it in a simple order for people. So you in the NLP, that's where I was going with it. I took all the, what do you call it, the involved stuff out of it, all the expert stuff like phobia releases and all that, and went, let's just keep this very simple. If you want to change the way you're thinking and feeling, you won't do it by changing the way you're thinking. If that's the way I'm thinking and I don't like it, that's how that's making me feel. If that's the way I feel, how would you prefer to feel? I feel this way. This is where I would go into, well, to change my feelings and go to these feelings, what would I be doing if I was feeling that way? Using all of my senses, visual, auditory, kinesthetic, olfactory, gustatory, what I'm smelling, what I'm tasting and all that sort of stuff, and seeing myself in that role. So if you start to feel differently, your body will line up with you, or your thoughts will line up with your body, because whatever you're feeling is going to come out in your thoughts, and whatever you're thinking is going to come out in your body language and other things. So by changing the way I'm feeling, by saying that's the way I don't want to feel, this is the way I do want to feel, this is all the stuff I'd be doing if I was feeling that way, your thoughts are aligned to it. So it's a process of anything is going down into the emotions. The deeper you get into the emotions, the more it becomes real. So if you're talking to somebody, it's a matter of having a bit of an understanding of where they're at, know their personality before you talk to them by doing that profile of their photograph, walk in, start chatting to them or on the phone, and find out what's important to them. Why is that important to them? What would it mean if they had that? Does it worry them if they don't have that? And the more they can understand what they're after, the more then you've built a picture for them, the more they like to do business. Because most people don't know what they don't know. Your job then is to show them what they don't know in a way in which they realize that's something they do want. So if you've got a service or a product, you're not selling the product. What you're selling, first of all, is you. That rapport, that trust. While you're talking to them and you're focused on them and you're asking them questions, they're giving you an idea of what's important to them. You ask them about that, you take them deeper into that. At the end of it, they go, oh, yeah, I really do need what you're talking about. And at that point, that's when they're interested in your service. And that's when the sale starts. The beginning of it is just the whole lot of it. The bulk of the conversation is going to be building rapport. Because I have a set rule. If I meet somebody new, if they want to talk to me or I want to connect with them, I'll get in touch and say, look, I just want to have a chat with you to find out who you are, find out why you do the things you do, see if there's possible collaborations, possible joint ventures, strategic alliances, et cetera. And they go, well, what about, do you want me as a client? And they go, no, let's find out about whether we like each other first. That will come. And I build a relationship with them because their network is also the people that I can do business with. But I just get them as a client, I can't get that. So I want to connect with them. I want to build rapport for a multiple of reasons. So it's, you have that their support when they to share and refer me to their networks. But at the same time, in building rapport with them, they're going to do business with you for a longer period of time. Instead of just buying one product and going away, they'll keep coming back because they'll keep coming back to where they enjoy with the people they like.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. And also what you said with, you know, like really painting that picture. I mean, I like to do that with my clients, really taking deep to like letting them see what it is that they want and letting them feel it and really paint that really nice picture. Because a lot of people, they don't think that they ever can do it. You know, they're like, okay, they want to maybe become successful in their business, but deep down they're like, yeah, they can't do it. But by really connecting them with, you know, what they want and why they want and really paint that picture, usually, you know, I get people to, you know, leave the session, you know, with a smile on their face and like really feeling more motivated, because now they know, you know what, there are so many possibilities out there. It is possible to achieve the things that they want to achieve. And so I really like how you explain it, and that's what I really do as well with my clients, is really just connect them with the possibility and finding out what it is that they want. I think we all need to do that, especially when we want to work with someone and provide really great value. We really need to find out, you know, first build a rapport and then really find out what it is that they want and really show them that it is possible.
That's right. And as you just said then, you also listen to the words they use and the sentence structure. You kept on saying you wanted to paint a picture. You're a visual person, so I know that when I'm talking to you, I'm going to go ask you questions like, can you see what I'm talking about? Now, that to somebody who is more auditory is going to say, well, that's a bizarre. I can't, what do you mean see what you're talking about? To a visual person, they go, oh, yeah, I can see that. So to an auditory person, they're going to be talking about sounds. They're going to be asking, well, how does that sound to you? And somebody who's kinesthetic, it's all about the feelings. So you're getting a feeling for what I'm saying. So I will listen to like the words they use, and then I will mirror those back to them, not the actual words or the sentences they're saying, but are they talking visually? Are they talking auditory or kinesthetically? Therefore, it's no use talking to a kinesthetic person about painting pictures because they're a lower frequency. They need to be able to have that time to touch it and feel it. So I will put it in their hands in the conversation, so to speak. I'll make it so that they can actually get a feeling for it. They can feel like they're actually holding it, that it's theirs. The auditory person, it just has to sound right to them. And the visual person, yeah, it's got to paint that picture. So I'll talk about imagery and things that they can then start to see. And while I'm talking to them, watching where their eyes are going, a visual person will be looking up going, yeah, I can see that. Because it's a visual's up. Auditory's out here. And down below is your kinesthetic and your internal dialect, you know, the way we think, the thoughts that we have. Like you ask a child, did you do that? And they go, no, I didn't. Their head will go straight down into the kinesthetic and internal thing because they're worried about being caught out. But if I'm talking to somebody and I'm talking about painting a picture, they'll look up if they're kinesthetic, and I'll be talking about, you know, getting a feeling for that. They'll be looking down and going, yeah, I am. Yeah. So I know that I've got that connection with them. So speak their language. Listen to them. So, again, active listening. You have to be active listening to pick all those cues up. So yeah, first
and
thing,
that was NLP, right? Because I remember that from when I was doing some training on NLP, that whole kinesthetic and all that. I mean, it was kind of confusing to me. Maybe that was like the whole language barrier, maybe. But initially, it was like, what are they talking about? I had no clue what they were talking about. So I actually had to like make a lot of notes. But I'm guessing that was from the whole NLP training, what you were talking about.
That's right. But you'll find that, well, you like the big picture. And you talk about painting a picture. So the facial features are giving me a bit of an indication of whether you're going to be visual, auditory, or kinesthetic. Now, if you're visual, painting, like a picture's worth 1,000 words. And there's a lot more feelings underneath that again. So you've got the visual is a high frequency, faster moving. The auditory is a little bit slower. The kinesthetic, that's like sitting in a lounge chair and just feeling comfortable and just taking it easy, sitting on the porch outside the house on a summer's day. So that's the way people will speak as well, in the tone of the way the speed is that they speak. So you listen to all that. But the facial features, by knowing those first of all, you can start to build rapport quickly. While you've got that connection and got the person then asking the right questions, so the person starts talking more than you do, they become you're a great conversationalist because you're sitting there listening. They're talking about their favourite subject. So you get them onto themselves. What is important to them? Why is that important to them? And they'll relay that because you've already started building rapport. You're talking to their traits. Then you take them deeper into their emotions and you're listening to the sentence structure they're using in the conversation. And you know straight away, and they're the visual, auditory, kinesthetic. There's so much information, and with a few skills, you're playing with all that information and making instant rapport with somebody to the point that you realize you didn't sell a thing. But my God, a lot of people were buying off you because they bought you as the connection. They trust you. Then everything else you've said is right. Your body language, your expressions, and the words you're using all correlate with each other. So they can trust you at that level as well. And at that point, they're happy to do business with you. So we have people who will buy off us any time of the day, regardless what we're selling. We've got a group of people who will never buy off us. There's about 10% at each end of the scale. 80% in between are the ones who will, the ones we've got to actually convince. So make it easy for yourself. By following that process, more of that 80% will become your clients, and you'll be doing less talking in the process to do it. So your time talking to somebody is shortened, the sales cycle is reduced in time, and your success rate goes through the ceiling.
Wow. Well, that was really great. And I mean, I think we could be talking about this, you know, for another couple of hours, but unfortunately I don't want to keep the listeners on too long. I think we kept them on for too long already. But now, Alan, I mean, if anyone would like to get in touch with you, how can they do the work? Can they find you?
The best way is to my website, which is alanstevens.com.au. It's Alan with one L and Stevens with a V. If they go to the homepage, they'll find the mobile apps there. They'll find the links to the book as well. There's also a newsletter link. If they sign up there, they will actually get a segment of the book, which will give them a number of traits to actually play with straight away, free of charge. And they can keep in touch with me that way. There's also a contact form there. If they want to talk to me, they can do that. And so just fill that out, put in whether they'd like to talk to me. If they're on Skype, give me their Skype address, and we will organise a time when we can have a chat.
Okay,
and great. Of course, first chat is always free.
Okay, great. And now, as far as, I mean, you mentioned free. I mean, is there anything you would like to give the listeners, like as a little gift or anything for, you know, being here with the who signed up for the Business Excellence Summit? Do you have anything for them?
Yeah, well, one of the things I did with my connections on LinkedIn before, I said to them, well, look, people are going to be looking at your profile, look at your image there, and make a decision very quickly. Now, you want them to make the right decision. You want them to call you or connect with you because they want to do business with you. So give me your link and I'll have a look at your image and I'll give you a quick rundown on what people are seeing and how you should change that image if it needs to be changed. So I've had that, but I also realised while I was thinking about it, some of your listeners won't be on LinkedIn. They might just be on Facebook. If they do the same thing, if they go to my Facebook page, and I'm easy to find, if they just do a search on celebrity profiler, they'll find both my personal page and my business page. So if they mention that it's the Business Excellence Summit, where they've come from, I'll look at their profile, give them a quick read on how people see them, and if it's on their LinkedIn page in particular, how they can improve that image.
Okay, great. I mean, do you want like maybe directly email you, or do you rather have them just go through your Facebook or LinkedIn page to contact you?
Well, if they pull their Facebook link out or their LinkedIn link, the URL, they can then go to my form on my website. That's probably the best way to go. Go to the form on the website, put it in there and just send me an email. And while you're on the website, go off to the testimonial page and just get a bit of a feel for where this has been used and how effective it is. As I say, some of those testimonials are 3 and 4 years after the fact.
Okay, well, I definitely will check them out too. And I will put the link to your page and stuff under the video too, so it's easier for the listeners to get to it. But now, Alan, I mean, I want to thank you for being here, for taking time out of your busy day to really, you know, share your wisdom and knowledge with me and the listeners. I mean, I got a lot out of it. It's really great to learn more about the faith, how to really, you know, read someone or at least get a little bit of insights in that and, you know, how beneficial it can really be. So really, thank you for being here. It was really great. I really enjoyed having you here.
It was my pleasure. I really hope that your listeners got a lot out of it.
Thank you. So we had Alan Stevens on for today as my guest expert. And I mean, like I said, you know, if you want to learn more about, you know, reading someone, learning someone's trade, I mean, it's going to be beneficial for your business. Like he said, you know, you will be able to close more often. It will be a lot more smoother. So you won't be, you know, working so hard to obtain clients. So, you know, really just, you know, maybe look into it just to see how you like it. And so I want to thank you for being here, and I will see you guys tomorrow with another great expert and another great topic that will be sharing a lot of great information that will help you become more successful in your business. So I will talk to you guys tomorrow. Bye.